Welcome to Cooperstown, New York, baseball capital of the world. Good afternoon, everyone. I'm Jim Nance, and behind me is the National Baseball Hall of Fame. Inside this museum are kept baseball memories and treasures of years gone by.
Like this tribute to Bobby Thompson and his shot heard around the world in 1951 against the Dodgers. Case honoring Lou Brock, who broke Maury Will's single-season stolen base record with number 105.
Ruthven checks him. He is going. The pitch is a strike. The throw. He is there. He did it. 105 for Lou Brock.
The exhibit commemorating Bill Mazeroski's ninth-inning home run to beat the Yankees, Game 7, 1960.
Here's a swing and a high fly ball.
This tribute to the Yankee Clipper, Joe DiMaggio, whose baseball accomplishments are legendary.
Joe DiMaggio up. Outfield deep, round toward left, the infield overshifted. Here's the pitch. Swung on, belted. It's a long one. Deep in the left center. Back for Gianfrido. Back. He makes a one-handed catch against the bullpen. Oh, doctor.
These are just a few of the remarkable achievements in baseball history. Wouldn't it be wonderful if these memories could come alive one more time?
And that's exactly what has happened. A collection of 52 old-timers, including home run king Hank Aaron, Joe DiMaggio, Brooks Robinson, new Hall of Fame inductees Billy Williams and Catfish Hunter, Armand Killebrew and Al Kaline. They've all gathered here at RFK Stadium in Washington, D.C. for the 6th annual National Old-Timers Baseball Classic.
Who's an old-timer? I'm no old-timer. I'm a young fella. What the heck? I don't know what I'm doing here.
Sweet Swinging Billy's going downtown tonight.
We'll kill him. We'll kill those National Leaguers.
I'm still the human vacuum cleaner. Sometimes.
So. See my Vaseline?
No.
Where'd you put it?
It's in my pocket.
Oh, I got it.
The National Old Timers Baseball Classic is sponsored by Budweiser. Beechwood aged for that clean, crisp taste. This Bud's for you. Valvoline Motor Oil, where motor oil is not just motor oil. And by Schick, maker of the Schick disposable razor and the new Schick Plus for the easy touch.
Welcome, everyone, this time from our nation's capital, Washington, D.C., for the 6th annual National Old Timers Baseball Classic. You know, today we could really sit back and recollect many of our most fond baseball memories as we have an outstanding collection of old-timers, a group that includes 15 Hall of Famers. I guess it couldn't be any more appropriate than to have working with me a Hall of Famer, Mel Allen. Mel, it's indeed an honor to be working with you. You've been calling the Yankees since 1939, calling baseball since 1938, and I know you've seen many of these outstanding players here today.
I sure have, and I've broadcast their achievements. And just think, Jim, they're all living legends. And we look forward, fans, to them giving us one more thrill one more time.
It will be a lot of fun, Mel. And working with us also will be the former first baseman of the St. Louis Cardinals, Bill White. And Bill is standing by with the all-time home run king, Henry Aaron.
Thanks, Jim. Hank Aaron, last year you guys lost this ball game 19-2.
Well, Bill, first of all, I wasn't here. But it's, as I said before, it's not that I'm going to make up for 17-run deficit. But I understand that it's always good to let the opposition win one every now and then. You know, that's what we used to do when you were in the National League.
Yeah, that's right. I'm amazed by the way you guys really have the spirit and want to play this ball game.
Well, Bill, it's a lot of fun, you know, and I think what happens when you put on the uniform, that old competitive spirit, it comes out in you. You want to do the best you can. We can't do as much, can't run as fast, can't hit the ball as far as we used to, but you still do the very best you can. The thing that makes it so amazing about this game is that when you look in the stands and you see so many old and young people, you know, because half of these young people were not around when myself, Lou Kaplan, and some of these old people were playing, you know, but when you walk up to the plate and they clap and wave for you, it just makes you feel, and little goose pimples come out on you, you know.
Well, it should be a great game. Hank, good talking to you.
Thank you very much, Bill.
Hank Aaron.
Three Hall of Famers coming up for the American League in the top of the first. Luke Appling, Bobby Doerr, and Al Kaline.
Over 23,000 on hand at RFK Stadium for the National Old Timers Baseball Classic.
The National League will be the home team. Dick Allen at first base. Playing second, the former Pirate great, Bill Mazeroski.
The 1960 World Series hero.
16-year veteran, Roy McMillan at shortstop. And at third, Don Kessinger. Of course, we all remember him with the Chicago Cubs. His Cub teammate starts off a Hall of Fame outfield. Billy Williams in left. In center, it'll be Lou Brock.
Looks like he can still play baseball.
In right field, the all-time home run king, Hank Aaron. Behind the plate, former All-Star catcher for the Braves, Del Crandall. And opening up on the mound for the National League, the all-time winningest left-hander, Warren Spahn. 363 victories. 80-year-old Luke Appling will lead off for the American League. He's also managing tonight. Appling led off the Classic 5 years ago in memorable fashion.
Would you believe the man in the batter's box is 75 years old? I have trouble believing it myself. It's luscious Luke Appling. Look at that fly ball deep to left. That's pretty well hit. Back. It's a home run! A home run for Appling! I don't believe it! Wow!
Old aches and pains, and he'll be stepping in here to face Warren Spahn to lead us off tonight.
Deja vu.
Again with that confrontation and the pitch high and away, and Appling, a two-time batting champ in the American League's, heading back to the dugout.
I think Appling wanted to strike. Spahn got the ball up and away.
So really an honorary first pitch confrontation, and Johnny Pesky will step in now and really be the first batter here for the American League.
This guy's a good hitter, Jim. Very much underrated.
Lined up the middle, a base hit for Johnny Pesky, and gets past Lou Brock in center, but Pesky will hold for a single to get things underway.
They talked about those Boston teams, Doerr and Williams, but Johnny Pesky, I think, started a lot of things for those Red Sox.
Well, Warren Spahn is going out of the game, just like Luke Appling, and Gaylord Perry will take over. Stepping in against him, Bobby Doerr, Hall of Famer, 1986, now 69 years old, minor league hitting instructor for the Blue Jays, and this one, grounded to third, Kessinger over to Mazeroski, back over to Dick Allen, and a double play.
Same old Boston Red Sox.
Think Gaylord had that pitch loaded up?
He probably did.
Al Kaline, the youngest player ever to win a batting title, the age of 20.
A couple of months younger than Ty Cobb was when he won his first batting crown.
Ground ball to McMillan. Over to Dick Allen, and the American League is out on the top of the first. Gaylord Perry, the two-time Cy Young Award winner, comes in and sets him down. So we head now to the bottom of the first, and coming up for the National League, leading off, it'll be Lou Brock, nice. Billy Williams, and Hank Aaron.
Against the
bottom of the first in the National Old Timers Baseball Classic, here's Bill White.
Thank you, Jim Nance. Defensively for the American League, we've got Big Bull Powell at first base.
The Key West Clouder.
And at second base, great player Bobby Doerr, Hall of Famer from Boston. And his teammate, those great teams, the shortstop will be Johnny Pesky.
They played in the 46 World Series.
And over at third base is Brooks Robinson.
He was always a World Series hero, dude.
And the big guy out in left field for the American League, Harmon Killebrew, the Minnesota Twins.
He looks slim down.
He has lost weight. The center fielder is Roy White. He's replacing Al Kaline, who batted and was taken out. And out in right field, a guy with a great arm, Mel Rocky Colavito.
He used to enjoy once in a while going in to pitch an inning or two.
And Bill Freehand of the Tigers behind the plate. And on the mound for the American League, Early Wynn. 300 wins for Early Wynn, and even 300.
He kind of had a struggle for that 300th one, but I admire him for it.
He didn't mind knocking you down either.
No.
So Lou Brock better be careful. Brock leading off for the National League, bottom of the first, no score.
Lou Jr. was just recently drafted in the second round by the San Diego Chargers of the NFL.
If he can run as fast as Lou, he ought to have been an offensive back.
I think Gurley's a little upset. Jim Perry coming on to take his place after he threw that strike to Lou Brock.
You know, speaking of father-son combinations, Chris Perry, the son of Jim, is starring right now on the PGA Tour. Had two top 10 finishes here the last month.
Through the right side, pass, Boog Powell, base hit for Lou Brock. Colavito will get it in, and Brock will hold at first base with a single.
I remember when Powell could lean over and get that ball.
Oh, with Lou Brock on at first base, here's a sweet swinger from Whistler, Alabama, a new member of the Hall of Fame, Billy Williams.
Is that right, me and Catfish Hunter, huh? Oh, that is really beautiful. Thank you, Jerry, for calling. Yeah, I ain't going nowhere. Oh, man, that's beautiful. Come here, girl. Come here. We made it.
Billy Williams made it to the Hall of Fame this year, but Cooperstown was only a dream when Billy broke in with the Cubs, winning Rookie of the Year honors in 1961, and he became one of baseball's top hitters. Ended up with a 290 batting average, 426 homers over an 18-year career.
That's it. Back she goes. Back, back, back. Hey, hey! He did it! Billy Williams coming through with that sweet swing of his.
I enjoyed hitting. I knew everything about my body, what I did when I hit a baseball. And I know there was a combination of the lower body, and you had to get your hands and arms into the baseball with great timing.
He also exhibited great timing in left field, snatching many a Cub victory from defeat.
However, it's Billy Williams coming from nowhere to save that play.
Billy became the Cubs' Iron Man, was honored with his own day when he broke the National League record for consecutive games played, eventually 1,117 games in a row.
In a situation like this, there's a long line of people you should think in this predicament. And of course, the one big man you could think is the Almighty God.
I didn't want anybody to take my job. When I came up, I tail off. And I sit on the bench for a long time. I didn't get a chance to play. And I said to myself, if I get back in the lineup, I'm going to try to play till this uniform is torn off me.
Hey, hey, holy mackerel, no doubt about it, the Cubs are on their way.
Chicago could do no wrong in 1969, and after years of frustration, Billy and the Cubs seemed destined for the World Series. But then fate turned on the Cubs. They started to collapse. The Mets overtook Chicago. The Cubs' World Series dreams were over.
It was the most dejected baseball season there was. It seemed like when they overtook us that, we couldn't come back. We tried everything, but we just couldn't bounce back on it.
Today, he's the Cubs' hitting instructor. Chicago fans are hoping Billy can teach his students that sweet swing. As for Billy, he'd like to manage.
I think it's a challenge. I want a challenge as a player. I like challenge as a coach. And I think this is a foul and great challenge that I could get as being a manager of a ball club.
And Billy Williams has certainly paid his dues since retiring from baseball as an active player. So Brock at first, nobody out, bottom of the first, no score. Jim Perry on the mound. Face it, Williams, straightaway center field. That's Roy White out there, and Brock will hold at second base.
He's still got that sweet swing.
So the National Leaguers now on the bottom of the first, they've got a threat going, and they've got Hank Aaron in. How'd you like Hank Aaron batting Mel Allen with men on base?
I'd like to have him batting solo.
305 career lifetime batting average, 755 home runs, and there goes 756.
How about that?
Henry Aaron, I think every time he comes in here, he hits a home run. And the National League now leads 3-0 on that home run by Hank Aaron. And a lot of National League fans celebrating. Lou Brock scores. Here comes Billy Williams, and he will score. And Henry Aaron enjoying the home run here, giving the National League a 3-0 lead in the bottom half of the first inning.
Aaron hit home runs here in 84 and 85.
Well, you never lose that swing. He's got a quick bat. He's quick inside. A lot of players don't like the ball inside, but Hank can he can get the batter out inside.
He's still enjoying it just as much as he did in regular season play.
And how do you like those high fives?
Yeah.
Here's Dick Allen now. You can call him Dick or you can call him Richie.
My actual name is Richard, and my family and people that know me well around home, I've always been Dick. And when I came to Philadelphia, somehow or another, they called me Richie. Going over to Chicago, Chuck Tanner being from home, he called me Dick just like everybody else, and somehow or another it got written that I didn't want to be called Richie. And so right up until now, you know, I guess people think that I detest the Richie or I changed my name, but that's not so.
Bill, you were a roommate and teammate of Mr. Allen. What do you call him?
I always called him Richie, but I always was very careful calling him Richie. Driven straightaway center field. Roy White is on the move, and he will not get it. And it looks like White might be hurt. as Dick Allen has just given the National League a 4-0 lead with his home run straightaway center field.
Boy, that one was really hit straightaway center.
He used a 42-ounce bat when he played baseball, one of the heaviest, Mel, outside of maybe Babe Ruth.
Babe used one even heavier at times. But I was interested there. He hit an outside pitch straightaway center over that fence.
Well, he likes the ball out over the plate. Very, very quick with the bat, just as Aaron is quick with the bat. Richie might be just a little bit stronger. So the National League now leads 4-0 on the 3-run home run by Hank Aaron and the solo shot by Dick Allen. And here's Del Crandall, the National League catcher. He's got a base hit straightaway center field, giving Roy White a workout. And you see Roy visibly limping out there in center field as Crandall holds it first with a single.
That ball looked as if it hit a rabbit hole.
Here's Bill Mazeroski, the former Pirate second baseman. His lifetime batting average, .260. In the right field, Colavito can't get to it. Just under the glove. Rocky will hustle the ball into second base. And Crandall will hold there. So the National League now, they have runners at first and second. Still nobody out. And they lead 4-0. And we're still in the bottom half of the first inning as Roy White, Mel, will lead.
And Willie Horton comes in to play right field with Rocky Colavito moving from right field over to center field. And the batter is Don Kessinger, who hits one back up the middle for a base hit. Ball being fielded by Colavito. He whips a throw in, trying to get Crandall. Crandall hits the dirt, and he is in there. He scores. Bill Freehan said he didn't. Crandall says he's in there.
Well, I don't know about that one, Mel.
The thing on Crandall's mind was to slide or not to slide. National League leading 5-0.
You know, what pride these guys have, Mel, to come out and in a game like this. Boy, do they want to win. Crandall hitting the dirt, and I thought it was a pretty good throw by Colavito. Watch the left leg of Freehan blocking the plate.
They still love to put all they've got into this game. I think he got a toe in there. Let's see this time from a different angle. Crandall's right toe made it. Let's see what Bill White may have to say.
Del Crandall, you were known for your speed, obviously, when you played. Explain that slide to me.
Well, actually, I thought I was going to slide at least 4 or 5 inches. I didn't even slide at all. I just hit and kind of rolled. Guess you have to have some speed before you slide, right?
You enjoying this game?
Oh, yeah. I really do. Yeah, I got up from that slide, and I think I'm going to be able to catch another inning or two, so I'm okay.
Bob Feller is coming in to replace Jim Perry now that the National League is in the midst of a 5-run rally. 3 no-hitters, 12 one-hitters. We'll be back in just a moment.
Back here at RFK Stadium, we're still in the bottom half of the first inning, and the National leads 5-0 over the American League, and Roy McMillan will bat now against Bob Feller. A 3-run home run by Hank Aaron and a solo shot by Dick Allen and a great slide by Del Crandall. Popped up on the right side. Drew Powell hustling back, and there's one down. So that's the first out of the inning, 5-0 National League, as we look at Rapid Robert Feller, one of the greatest right-handers of all time.
They've been clocked close to 100 miles per hour. Strikeout kings like Dwight Gooden, rearing back like Roger Clemens. With the glare of a Rich Gossage, power pitchers like Nolan Ryan. But one of baseball's first strikeout artists was a man known as Rapid Robert, Bob Feller. And on a sunny day in 1940, the baseball world found out just how fast he was. It was Feller's fastball versus a speeding motorcycle, and guess who won?
I went ahead and did my full windup, and the motorcycle goes by, and I throw the ball with everything I had, and as luck would have it, on the first toss, this ball didn't right into the bullseye. Not in the bullseye, but in the middle of it. It beats the motorcycle by 3 feet, and that's the way it happened, and you couldn't do that again in the rest of your life.
His life began on a small farm in Van Meter, Iowa, where the scouts came flocking, offering Feller his first contract at age 16, putting him in a major league uniform at age 17.
I'm the youngest pitcher to ever start a game, win a game, and to complete a game, and strike out 15. No one has done all that, and I'm proud of it.
20 years with the Indians, 15th on the all-time strikeout list, a major league record 12 one-hitters, 3 no-hitters, and 266 career wins. All this despite losing 4 years in his prime to serve his country during World War II. But Feller never considers what if.
The only thing that bothers me too much is, in all the encyclopedias, I don't say all of them, most of them, where it lists the major league ball players, it has nothing besides anybody's name to say they're in military service. All it has is a blank. I think that's a disservice, it's an oversight, and I resent it.
There have been plenty of great pitchers since Bob Feller last took the mound in 1956. And you just have to wonder, could any of them compare with the man called baseball's greatest living right-hander?
There's one pitcher that being the same caliber I was in my prime, Sandy Koufax, nobody else.
Today, Feller travels three times as much as when he played, making appearances for the Indian Speakers Bureau and at baseball card shows. And he still receives plenty of fan mail.
Cy Young, did you?
Yes.
Do you know Larry Doby?
Of course, my teammate.
How many years did you play?
Oh, 20, it's a long time. 20, I guess.
Rapid Robert Feller, the pride of Van Meter, Iowa. Cleveland's mark of excellence. Leaving his mark, a K, in the hall in Cooperstown. Still loving the outdoors, proving you can take the boy out of the country, but you can't take the country out of the boy.
Bob Feller facing runners at first and second with one out here in the bottom of the first inning, 5-0 National League, and Orlando Cepeda's a batter with the count 3-2. And that's ball four. Breaking ball just missed inside. Cepeda doesn't want to walk. And he'll go on to first base. And we'll have the bases loaded.
I can see why he doesn't want to walk.
So Perucin, the baby bull Cepeda, on at first base.
What'd you call him, Bill?
Perucin. They also called him the baby bull over here in the United States. But his father was a great ball player over in Puerto Rico. And we're going to have a pinch runner for Cepeda, Bill Verdon, the 1955 Rookie of the Year. Here's Lou Brock batting for the second time in the inning. Base is loaded, one out, 5-0. And that base hit the right field, Horton charging. And Mazeroski scores easily. And the National League with their eighth base hit of the ball game. We're still in the bottom half of the first, and once again, Billy Williams. Base is loaded. Dripping to right center field, it'll get past Horton to go to the wall. Kessinger will score. Here comes Verdon, he scores. Lou Brock cruising around, he takes his time. Now he will score, and the National League leads 9-0.
Priam trying to block Brock off the plate.
So the National League, 9 runs here in the bottom of the first, and Bob Feller is being roughed up. He'll pitch to Hank Aaron. Of course, Williams stayed at first base. Normally, that would have been a double for Billy Williams. Aaron down the left field line, grabbed by a fan, but it'll be played in by Harmon Killebrew, and Aaron will hold it first with a single. So Aaron on at first base, and Billy Williams down at second, still only one out, and here's Dick Allen. 9-0 National League. We're still in the bottom half of the first inning. Popped up. Free hand. Throws the mask away, and they're two outs in foul territory. Bill Freehand looking at the lights. Those catchers always remember how to catch those foul pops.
You mean throwing off the mask first?
Yep, throwing the mask off, and they know that ball's going to come back to them. Here's Del Crandall. Two outs now, two on base, Bob Feller. On the ground to short. That's Pesky, a backhand door, and that'll retire the side. The National League scores 9 runs on 10 hits. And after one full inning of play, the National League 9, the American League nothing. Coming up, Harmon Killebrew, Boog Powell, and Brooks Robinson.
WBC number one.
We're back at RFK Stadium in Washington, the National Old Timers Baseball Classic. And on the mound now for the National League, Gaylord Perry, the only pitcher ever to win a Cy Young Award in both leagues.
On May the 6th, 1982, Gaylord Perry, one out away from 300. The 2-1 pitch to Randolph. Swung on, ground ball to Cruz. This should do it. He's got it. It's over. Gaylord has 300.
It was exciting. It was like, you know, the topping on a cake, finishing your career. And when things aren't going just right now, I put the tape on. You see Dave Niehaus. He's describing the play and the excitement going on. And it really gives you a great pickup. So I watch it now and then.
But along the way to 300, Gaylord had countless other highlights, including a no-hitter in 1968 against the eventual National League champion St. Louis Cardinals. It was that kind of pitching which allowed Gaylord and his brother Jim to become the winningest brother combination in Major League history. That record stood until the ageless Negro brothers broke it this year.
I had the feeling they were going to break it eventually, and so I'm pulling for old guys to keep playing because I know how much I love it. I'd still be playing if I could find somebody to let me play.
If it were up to umpires and opposing hitters, Gaylord would never have played, as he was constantly scrutinized for throwing the illegal spitball. Hitters recognized when a baseball took unnatural turns after leaving Perry's hand. But he was never thrown out of a game until 1982, when umpire Dave Phillips detected a familiar scent around the pitcher's mound.
When I went out to the mound one time, my eyes actually got watery because it's, you ever go into a, in your child's bedroom with Vicks?
Oh, sure.
I think he used some kind of a Vicks. And he also, I might add, he was a very good pitcher and an extremely competitive pitcher, but he also threw an illegal pitch.
If I was pitching against Pete Rose tomorrow, I'd go shake hands with him today and I'd have my handful of grease to get him to think about it. Say, hey, Pete, how you doing? Oh, I didn't know I had grease on my hand. And, you know, he would start thinking about it. Or I'd take a baseball and cover it with grease and roll it over to Herman Franks when he was managing the Cubs, and he'd pick it up, he'd get all mad, you know, and I'd wave at him.
Today, he keeps the definition of a spitball in his office at Limestone College in South Carolina, where he's the school's first ever baseball coach. He also coaches the local American Legion team, and his pitchers are eager to learn the pitch that made their coach so famous.
They've been on me since the first day. Hey, how do you throw that pitch? And I said, look, get in great shape. Let's get your other stuff together. And then we'll talk about it.
But some of them already emulate their mentor. And during batting practice, they occasionally leave little reminders of his promise.
What's that doing in here, huh? Gee, with this kid to do anything.
Bill White, when Gaylord Perry changed leagues, did he change brands of Vaseline?
You know, he had one of the best spitters around, Mel. I think only Lou Burdette might have had a better spitter than Gaylord Perry.
Top of the second, Harmon Killebrew. Grounds one to Don Kessinger at third. Throw on over first in time for the out.
Notice these guys aren't firing that ball across the diamond. There's a little arc on it now.
The runners are not running as fast at home plate. Boog Powell comes up. He was quite a slugger with the Orioles. And he lifts a high fly ball out into center field. Lou Brock makes the catch one-handed.
That's the toughest play now for today's player. You know, your eyes go once you get into the 40s, and it's tough to focus. And I always a little bit shaky when the ball goes up in the air.
Legs go too, don't they?
Yeah, but the eyes first, I think.
Brooks Robinson played 23 years in the majors, takes it high for a ball.
Gaylord's getting it up there pretty good.
Yeah.
And throwing sidearm.
I was going to say that. Curveball hit high in the air to left field. Billy Williams waiting at the wall, makes the catch, and the American League is down in order. No runs, no hits, no errors. And the score at the end of an inning and a half remains the National League 9, the American League nothing. Due up for the National League, Bill Mazeroski, Don Kessinger, and Roy McMillan.
Jim Grant's along with Mel Allen and Bill White as we head to the bottom of the second. Catfish Hunter comes in for the American League to face Bill Mazeroski. Catfish at age 39, the youngest player in this game tonight. And he'll be heading to Cooperstown for the Hall of Fame later this month. Mazeroski lines one, caught by Pesky. Nice play by Pesky. And, well, you look back, he's had a play he's had to live with now for 41 years.
It happened in the last half of the eighth inning. Game seven, score tied, single to left center. Slaughter, on his way to third, decides to score. Now, the question was, did Pesky hesitate on his relay to the plate? The winning run.
I'd have needed a rifle to shoot him out.
And a lot of people said that I did this and I did that. And I had to live with it. The first couple of years, I was real sensitive to it. But you stop and you think about it. You know deep down in your heart you didn't do the wrong thing. Although people will blame you for it. And I've been called a bum even to this day. I've had people's grandkids come up and say, "You bum, what'd you hold the ball for?"
Now an assistant to the general manager of the Red Sox, the pesky story just part of a long list of baseball folklore. And will that argument really ever be resolved, Mel?
By Enos Slaughter. He noticed that Culberson had replaced Dom DiMaggio in center field.
And Dom DiMaggio not only had a good arm, but he also played shallower.
A strike on Don Kessinger, who singled the first time up. Catfish Hunter, Cy Young Award winner, pitched a perfect game. Here's Kessinger, bouncing ball to Rojas to his left. And put out to Powell for out number two. So Catfish has retired the first two batters here in the bottom of the second. Hunter, incidentally, is a farmer now in Hertford, North Carolina. Roy McMillan steps up. Popped out in the first, but this one, long shot to left center, and McMillan has a home run, the third one of the night.
How about that?
Oh, Catfish got that ball up. He was a high ball pitcher and high sliders, and this is a typical Catfish pitch. He gives up the home run with nobody on base. Guys on base, that slider doesn't hang up there like that.
Well, one of the least likely guys to hit a home run in this old-timers classic, I guess you would say. Roy McMillan hit 68 homers during his 16-year career, and he has one tonight.
I'd say, Jim, these guys are throwing about 70-75%.
Orlando Cepeda, the 1967 MVP of the National League, and he's crushed one to left field. This is another home run. 11-0 now for the National League.
And that would have been a home run in the old ballpark.
And I think the hitters are swinging at 100%.
You know, it's 280 to left field, and Cepeda cleared that rather easily. Last year, the American League beat the National League 19-2. Do you think the National League is remembering that? Is it now 11-0 here in the second inning?
Well, I'm sure they are, and I'm sure we see Cepeda take his time rounding each base and then jumping on home plate. Orlando has a very, very, very bad knee. He had it operated on a couple of times. He finally had to leave baseball because of that, but he's happy.
Well, it'll be 50 in September, and he has a home run here tonight. Lou Brock steps in now for the third time, and again, we're only in the second inning. And Brock hits one in the hole for his third hit of the night. Orton brings it back in, but Lou Brock now 3-for-3 on the base paths, and that's dangerous. He's already scored two runs.
I don't think we'll see him try to steal here, though. 11-0. Of course, Brock would steal when he was running after the record. He didn't care what the score might have been.
Well, look out. Here's a line shot to right center by Billy Williams, and it's off the fence. Willie Horton will run it down. 3-for-3 now for Williams, and Lou Brock will hold it third.
That's a good relay. Now Powell has Billy Williams hung up between first and second on the throw.
Now Luke Powell, Lou Brock threatening to come home. Run down now. Cookie Rojas has to protect Lou Brock from coming in. Here's Brooks Robinson now, and they've got Brock held up between third and home. Freehand will run him down for the third out. What a crazy play here.
They had a lot of fun on that play, Bill.
Got some tired ball players out there after that rundown.
And everyone heads to the dugout with a smile on their face. Tack on two more runs for the National League in the bottom of the second. It's now 11-0, and due up in the third for the American League, Rocky Colavito, Bill Freehand, and Jim Catfish Hunter.
Back to the ball game in Washington. Among the fans who are watching the old-timers classic, Joe Theismann, former Redskin quarterback, and the man who succeeded him, Jay Schrader, and someone who has been in the news lately, Fawn Hall. How about that? How about him, Jim Bunning?
Well, you know, Mel, he's now a congressman from the state of Kentucky, Jim Bunning.
The cunning Mr. Bunning. He's pitched no hitters in both leagues. Rocky Colavito goes after a pitch and grounds it through the hole between third and short out in the left field. Rocky Colavito. Billy Williams threw the ball in. Rocky's got a lot of power. It didn't take much there. He just grounded it through. Bill Freehand, former Tiger catcher. And he smashes one between third and short in left field. Billy Williams fielding it. Colavito moves on down to second. Freehand is on first. And the batter is Catfish Hunter. Pretty good hitting pitcher, Bill.
excellent pitcher, Mel. That's why I worry about the DH. I'm not sure you need the DH. A good athlete like this ought to be able to swing the bat.
There's the ground ball, and it's through into left field for a base hit. And that loads the bases. With the National League leading by a score of 11-0, we're in the first half of the third inning. And coming up to bat now, as you see, Colavito on third, Freehan on second, Catfish Hunter on first, it's Dick McAuliffe. He also played with the Tigers at one time. There's a drive going to deep right center field. It is going, going, it is gone. A grand slam for Dick McAuliffe. And that makes the score 11-4. How about that? Rocky Colavito coming in the score, followed by Bill Freehan, and then Catfish Hunter. The American League trying to mount a rally here, trailing 11-0 as they came into the top half of this inning.
Well, McAuliffe belted that one right up onto a stage they have set up for a Madonna concert. You know, Washington wants a baseball team, but in the meantime, all they're holding here at RFK Stadium in the summer are rock concerts. And you can tell the field's a little torn up as a result.
Cookie Rojas grounds to short to Dick Groat, and Rojas is safe at first. Now let's go down to Bill White with Dick McAuliffe.
It looks like in your dotted dotage or whatever that you change your stance a little bit, not as open as it was before.
Yeah, I was telling Jim Cott, you know, when I played, you know, I was trying to hit the ball on the line. Now I'm in the old timers games, I'm going deep for the long ones. Drive the Cadillac, right?
Thanks, Jim.
With a score 11-4, Cookie Rojas on first. The batter is Willie Horton. There's a drive going, and he knows it. You saw him watching it deep in the left field seats for a home run. A two-run home run to make the score now. National League 11, the American League 6. Willie Horton.
Well, he really caught that one. I think that would have been out of any park. Well back in the seats in left field.
You saw him stand there and watch it.
Horton hit 325 homers on his career, 12-year career. Still works for the Tigers and lives between Seattle and Detroit, part-time at each.
11-6 in favor of the National League. We're in the first half of the third inning. Jim Bunning is wondering what's happened to him. Harmon Killebrew, the batter, and here's a look at his 500th home run.
Into his windup, delivers a curveball swung on. It's a high fly ball hit into deep left field. It's back deep. It's going, going. Number 500 for Harm Killebrew.
Well, hitting my 500th home run was kind of a special thrill. They had decided to put out a promotional coffee cup at Metropolitan Stadium for the fans to commemorate my 500th home run. And the day came when they were to deliver the cups. And I hadn't hit my 500th home run, and they gave the cups out anyway. Took me about a month to hit my 500th home run.
Harmon Killebrew altogether hit 573 home runs in his career.
That was more home runs than any right-handed hitter in American League history, Mel.
This time he hits a ground ball to Logan at third. He bobbles it. The throw to first base is a one-hopper in time for the out as Cepeda made his move over to first base. That's the first out of the inning.
Watch this again. A bad hop to Logan, and he gets his head up. He doesn't want to lose any teeth, but he stays with the ball, and he'll flip it over to Cepeda. Now, what surprises me is Cepeda actually touches first base. He spent a whole year without touching first. He had quick feet at first base.
You being a first baseman, you know about, as they say, cheating. Here's Boog Powell, another first baseman, and another power hitter, and there it is, all the way for a home run. The score 11-7 in favor of the National League.
Boog still has that quick bat. Just he's strong, big fella, and he did that quite often at Baltimore's Memorial Stadium. That ball just jumped out of here.
Boog's going to have a little fun with third base umpire Jim Honacek, a good friend. He'll make sure that he sees home plate. Working with Nick Colosi tonight and Jerry Neudecker, the other umpires. But, hey, that's seven runs for the American League, and they're right back in it here in the third.
And here's Brooks Robinson coming up. American League had a 14-run inning last year. Low for a ball. Rocky Colavito on deck. Jim Bunning on the mound. Brooks Robinson awaiting the pitch, and he drives it into left field for a base hit. Billy Williams kind of shied away from that, Bill.
Ole. We call that Ole, oh, Bill.
Rocky Colavito. 11-7, favor of the National League. And Rocky puts the good word to that one. And it is going, it is gone.
Can you believe all of these home runs? This is like what we're seeing this year in the major leagues. Of course, the big controversy, are the balls juiced up? Well, we checked before the game, and a different brand of baseball is being used here than the big leagues. But they were supposed to measure up to major league specifications.
Yeah, but they seem like they're golf balls here tonight.
100 compression.
They're flying out of here.
National League leading now in 11-9, and Jim Bunning with that congressional smile on his face as Bill Freehan comes to bat for the second time in the inning. He's already had one hit. There's a drive in the left center field, and it's in there for a ground rule double.
You know, Freehan last year shared the Classic MVP award with Rocky Colavito, who preceded him at bat with a home run, so they're starring once again.
With a score 11-9, Johnny Podres comes in to relieve Jim Bunning, and Podres' most memorable moment came in the World Series of 1955. Johnny Podres trying to protect a 2-0 lead in Game 7 of the World Series. Runners on first and second for New York, but Amoros makes a great catch. Throws to Reese. McDougal trying to get back to first base, but he is doubled up.
It was unbelievable because we went on and in that ball game we win it 2-0. But if it wasn't for Amoros, you know, the Dodgers might have still been looking for their first World Championship.
He's got that right. And Johnny Podres will be pitching to another pitcher, Catfish Hunter, and he's a pretty good hitting pitcher. 11-9, the score, favor in the National League. There's a drive deep to center field. It is going, it is gone. And that ties up the ball game. How about that?
Well, the Cat, not only a good pitcher and a good hitter, Mel, he's just a good all-around athlete. He's fielding his position well.
You know, Catfish really one of the pioneers in baseball, and that he was truly one of the first free agents that changed the whole face of baseball.
Along with Andy Messersmith, Kurt Flood.
You know, up at Cooperstown, they have the pen up there that he actually signed the million-dollar contract with the Yankees back in 1974.
Here's Dick McAuliffe. One away, 11 runs in.
Well, he got things started with that grand slam.
And there's a drive that's going foul.
That was a hanger, Mel. When Podres was active, he had an excellent fastball, a riding fastball, and a very good curveball, and a great changeup.
Dick McAuliffe grounds this one out to second to Glenn Beckert. On over to Cepeda, and they're two away in the first half of the third inning. Scored tied at 11-all, and that brings to the plate Ken Aspromonte. There's a high fly ball hit out in the left field. Billy Williams under it makes the catch, and the side is retired. At the end of 2.5 innings, the score, American League 11, National League 11. Coming up in the last half of the third inning for the National League, Hank Aaron, Bobby Thompson, and Joe Garagiola.
Moving to the bottom of the third in the National Old Timers Baseball Classic, tied at 11. Jim Nantz along with Mel Allen and Bill White. Coming up for the National League, Henry Aaron, the all-time home run king.
The Bambino, the Sultan of SWAT, Babe Ruth, 714 career home runs. A record that seemed unbreakable. But from the sandlots of Mobile, Alabama, came a right-handed slugger named Hank Aaron. Hammering Hank joined the Milwaukee Braves in 1954 and thus began his all-out assault on the immortal Babe's record.
There's a drive into left field. That ball is going, and out of here. Henry Aaron has just tied Babe Ruth.
4 days later, the unbreakable record was shattered.
The pitch by Downing. Swinging. There's a drive into left center field. That ball is going to be out of here. It's gone. It's 7-15. There's a new home run champion of all time, and it's Henry.
An ordeal ended, and the new king took a deep breath.
It was a tremendous pressure on me. For 2.5 years, it was. And I tell you, not so much from playing the game itself, but from listening to all of the talk. I never have tried to say I was better than Babe Ruth. I don't think I've ever used that those words before. And the only thing I wanted people to do is just to give me credit for what I had achieved. That's all.
He received that credit. Baseball's all-time home run and RBI king was overwhelmingly elected to the Hall of Fame on his first ballot. And today, he's still part of the Braves organization, vice president and director of player development, the highest-ranking black official in baseball. A significant title following the remarks of Al Campanis on national television.
This is ABC News Nightline.
I truly believe that they may not have some of the necessities to be, let's say, a field manager or perhaps a general manager.
That statement got Campanis fired and rocked the baseball world.
Mr. Campanis is not a bigot, he's not a racist, but I was grateful to Mr. Campanis for enlightening the world on what really baseball has been for 40 years since blacks have been in it.
With its America's game image damaged, baseball sought an answer.
Every team in Major League Baseball will have a strong and positive affirmative action program.
The commitment to an affirmative action plan, the hiring of a monitor, goals and timetables are certainly steps in the right direction.
As part of the Braves front office, Aaron wonders if blacks must prove they belong the way black ball players did in the 50s.
I just wanted to be right. This is America's game, and we just want to see some blacks be given an opportunity to work in the front office, that's all.
Henry Aaron, certainly a record setter in his playing days and now trying to lead an all-new level of progressive thinking in baseball. Almost another home run here for Aaron, who hit a three-run shot in the first inning. This one just fouled down the left side.
You notice, Jim, how he hits off his front foot. They tell you don't do that, but Henry's always done that.
I did that, too, but I never made the varsity.
Look at that concentration.
So with the game tied, Aaron hits a high fly to left field. Marvin Killebrew trying to get under it. No, he misjudged it there in left field. And they're going to score that a base hit for Aaron. He's now 3-for-3 with three RBIs. He's on first base with nobody out here in the bottom of the third.
And Harmon had trouble picking the ball up.
Bobby Thompson and Mel Allen, where were you when he hit the shot heard around the world?
At the Polo Grounds, there were two outs, and I was going to beat the crowd and run down the runway, but then my better judgment said, you better stay here until this ball game is over.
Thompson pops it up in the infield. A little confusion here, but Hunter makes the catch for out number one.
We're talking about Hunter's athletic ability. We saw it there, Jim, when Cleet Boyer had some problems picking the ball up.
Well, that brings up Joe Garagiola for the National League. One out, Henry Aaron on first. Ground ball to Mike Epstein. Makes the pickup. He's going to go to second and get the force for out number two. That'll put Garagiola now on first base with two outs. Game tied at 11 all in the bottom of the third. Glenn Beckert, former Chicago Cubs second baseman, steps in. Beckert, a part of that Chicago infield, included Ernie Banks, Ron Santo, and Don Kessinger. And he flies out to shallow center. Rocky Colavito with the catch. We are through three, and the game is all tied at 11. Coming up for the American League, it'll be Willie Horton, Harmon Killebrew, and Mike Epstein.
I'm not asking you who's on second.
Who's on first?
That's what I'm trying to find out.
Well, don't change the players.
I'm not changing nobody.
Take it easy.
What's the guy's name on first base?
What's the guy's name on second base?
I'm not asking you who's on second.
Who's on first?
I don't know.
He's on third. We're not talking about him.
How did I get on third base?
You mentioned his name.
If I mention a third baseman's name, who did I say is playing third?
No, who's playing first?
Stay off of first, will you?
Well, what do you want me to do?
Now, what's the guy's name on third base?
Well, what's on second?
I'm not asking you who's on second.
Who's on first?
I don't know.
He's on third.
There I go, back on third again.
Well, it's obvious those two fellas can't help us. Well, maybe Willie Horton can. He's batting here in the fourth inning with the score tied. Nationals 11, American League 11. And he ripped one in the center field. Base hit for Willie Horton. And Brock will get it in. And the American League has the leadoff runner on here in inning number four. And that'll bring up the left fielder for the American League, Harmon Killebrew.
Killebrew works radio and television games for the Twins, lives in Oregon during the offseason.
Lifts this one to right field. Billy Williams is there, and that's the first out in the fourth inning. Holding at first base is Willie Orton. And here's Mike Epstein. He played right here in Washington. Very popular here. And Epstein takes a breaking ball. Knocked down by the catcher. That's Lonis Bailey. Lonis Bailey of the Cincinnati Reds. We always called him Lonis. His name, Ed Lonis Bailey.
Pretty good hitter, too, Bill.
Good hitter. Good fastball hitter. That's too low. Ball two. Two balls, no strikes on Epstein. Willie Horton at first base. One away in the fourth inning. All tied. 11-11. That's inside. See, Potter's throwing a lot of breaking balls.
Epstein played on the 72 world champion Oakland A's. Hit 26 home runs that year, 1972.
And he'll let you know that, too, won't he? That's ball four. Mike doesn't want to leave. But Jerry Neudecker, the home plate umpire, sends him on the first base. I'm not sure he wants to stay there because Potter's got a pretty good curveball. But he wanted to get a whack at Johnny Potter. That'll move Horton down to second base. Epstein on at first. He's still upset, and that'll bring up Cleet Boyer, the third baseman. Right back up the middle pass, Padres. Becker to Grote, and he can't get him. That'll be an error, and they'll load the bases up for the American League. So the American League now, as Boyer might have pulled up lane at first base, they have the bases loaded and a chance to go ahead in the ball game. And the batter is Rocky Colavito, and he takes a strike from Johnny Padres.
You know, Rocky always bears down.
He's always in shape, too. Left field, that ball is gone. A grand slam home run for Rocky Colavito. And the American League now leads 15-11.
How about that?
Colavito is semi-retired, lives in Burnville, Pennsylvania, but he's been feasting on this classic the last 2 years. Last year is the co-MVP, had a home run then. Hasn't made an out in the last 2 years, and here he's perfect again, and this grand slam has the American League in front.
Horton, Epstein, Boyer, and then Colavito scoring, and it's 15-11 American League. Now we'll get Ralph Branca.
And Branca is remembered as the man who was called out of the bullpen to pitch to Bobby Thompson, who hit the home run and was heard around the world.
He's pitching to Bill Freehand. Ball is bobbled by Dick Grote. Not in time. Freehand beats it up. So Grote will get an error.
You know, Branca also won 21 games in 1947, including four shutouts. A lot of people don't remember that.
All they remember is a home run. Here's Bob Allison. Lifted to left field. This is Sam Jethro out there, and he misjudges the ball. Lou Brock will have to pick it up. And Freehand will hold at second base. Allison now on at first. That's another error here for the National League in the fourth inning. And the American League now runners at first and second. Here's Dick McAuliffe. Drill right center base hit. They're really giving Lou Brock a workout. Freehand scores. And the American League now leads 16-11. Ken Aspermonte. Johnny Logan at third base and throwing on to first. Not in time as the throw pulls the paint off. Looked like Logan slipped as he went over the third base.
He didn't have much behind his throw.
16-11, American League. Willie Horton driven deep to center field. No chance at all for Lou Brock. That ball well out of here. Horton, second home run of the ball game.
I'm amazed at these home runs we're seeing tonight. Catfish Hunter, Dick Allen, and now Willie Horton have all driven long shots over the center field wall.
And there's a score. The American League 19, the National League 11. We're still in the top of the fourth inning here at RFK Stadium in Washington.
A mere 30 runs here tonight.
Harmon Killebrew. It's popped up down the third base side. Logan can't get to it. Base hit. Now, there are a couple of lines there. The second line is on the inside park, so that's a fair ball. And Branca gives up. He'll give the ball to Bill Stoneman. He says, I've got enough.
He still wears the number 13.
You think he'd take it off by now,
yeah,
wouldn't he? That's been a good number for him. So Stoneman pitching to Mike Epstein. Epstein up for the second time this inning. Drills at the center field. And Lou Brock can't get it. He won't block it. And Brock will pick it up, and he'll hold on as Epstein will hold at first base with a single. You know what amazes me, fellas, that the hitters are on the ball. They're hitting the ball hard. Lead Boyer. Cepeda backing up, and he makes the final one-handed catch. And that's it, finally, for the American League. After 3.5, Americans 19, Nationals 11. Coming up, bottom of the fourth, Johnny Logan, Dick Groats, and also Orlando Cepeda.
The Yankee Clipper, number 5, Joe DiMaggio.
In 1941, DiMaggio hit in 56 consecutive games, an unsurpassed record. The same year, Ted Williams hit over 400, the last man to do so in the major leagues. DiMaggio was voted the Most Valuable Player Award. That caused quite an argument among fans. What did Joe think about it?
Well, it's a strange thing sometimes how they do determine who wins the MVP. Generally, it used to go to, and it has changed in time, that the fellow that had a good year but was with the winning team, they would favor. The writers would favor because he was more valuable because of the team when going on to win. And this is exactly what happened. The Yankees wound up winning that pennant. Ted Williams and the Boston Red Sox, they wound up in second place. Now, in my mind, it would have been beautiful. I would have not griped if he had won it. It was just the one boat that separated it. And if I had something to do with it, I would have cut that boat in half. We'd have both had half a piece anyway.
A championship remark, and that's what separates the superstars from the stars.
A gracious gentleman and a great player.
Right, Bill.
Bottom of the fourth inning, and it's American League 19, National League 11, and Milt Pappas now out on the mound for the American Leaguers, and he'll face Johnny Logan, a former Milwaukee star. He lifts one to left field. This time,
Bob Allison. There
is Bob Allison, and he makes the catch. I think some of the older outfielders having some problems picking the ball up, but Allison stayed with it for the first out.
I guess you get a little rusty when you haven't played in 10 or 15 or 20 years.
Here's Pittsburgh and Duke's Dick Groat. Dick was a pretty good basketball player at Duke and also for the Fort Wayne Pistons.
Most of his basketball records were broken last year by Johnny Dawkins. He held them for a long time.
He lifts one to center field, and Colavito is there. And that's out number two. Two outs, nobody on. Bottom of the fourth inning, the American League 19, the National League 11.
Milt Pappas setting him down. You know, he was involved in the trade for Frank Robinson. Robinson followed that up with the triple crown.
Cepeda, bad hop for McAuliffe. He's got plenty of time, and that'll retire the side. So Cepeda bounces out 6-3. And an easy inning for Milt Pappas, as Cepeda thought he might have loaded one up. But at the end of four, the American League 19 and the National League 11. Coming up for the American League, Rocky Colavito, Jim Price, and Bob Allison.
As we go to the first half of the fifth inning with the American League leading by a score of 19-11, Rocky Colavito comes to bat. Bill Stoneman on the mound for the National League. Ground ball hit the third. And it's in time for the out. One away. Jim Price, who caught for the Tigers, tells us about Mickey Mantle's last appearance at Tiger Stadium.
We had already clinched a pennant, and we were playing the Yankees, and Mickey's last appearance in Tiger Stadium, and Mickey came to the plate, and people gave him a standing ovation. I kind of stepped back and gave him center stage, and while I was doing that, McLean says, "Hey, big guy, come here a minute." So I ran out, and he said, "Let's let him hit one." I said, "Are you serious?" Then I thought right away, "Yeah, this is Denny McLean. He is serious." He said, "Ask him where he wants it." So I went behind the plate, and Mick, you know how Mick used to put his bat down on the plate and put his head down. I said, "Mick, where do you want it?" And he says, "Oh, you're kidding, you know, in that Oklahoma draw." I said, "No." I said, "McLean wants you to hit one out last time at bat in Detroit." He said, "Tell him high and tight, mediocre cheese." So I gave Denny the sign. The first pitch was a little bit outside, and Mickey kind of made a gesture like, you know, in a little bit. Next pitch was in. It was in too far, and he pulled it foul. Well, McLean had the greatest control in the world. The next pitch was right there, and he hit a bullet in the upper deck in Detroit. And Mickey's running around the bases, and Denny is running around with him clapping. And all of us were clapping. When he crossed home plate, I was standing back. He said, "Thanks."
You know, that's really a fascinating story.
It's unusual because very few pitchers like to give up home runs. And even so, very few hitters can hit a home run when they want to hit one.
Jim Price hits a line drive to Logan, who bobbles the ball, and he throws on to first base, but not in time to get Price.
That ball took a bad hop in the air on Logan.
He almost still got Price at first, though.
Here's Bob Allison, former great star for the Washington Senators. There's a drive deep to left field, going, it is gone. A two-run home run. And the American League leads now by a score of 21-11. How about that?
It was 11-0. That's 21 unanswered runs for the American League. Bob Allison lives in Minneapolis now as an executive for a soft drink company, and he has a home run tonight as well.
Here comes Big Bob. Nineteen hits for the American League, 15 for the National League. Man, they've scored a lot of runs. And here's Dick McCullough.
And these players are having a lot of fun, and it's for a good cause. Good cause.
It really is, Bill. It goes to the Association of the Professional Ball Players of America for needy ex-players.
And they get no publicity. They don't want publicity. They just want to help former players.
There's a high pop-up to Glenn Beckett. And he loses the ball in the starlight. How about that?
Well, Beckett had that same problem when he played with the Cubs. You know, that wind swirling around at Wrigley Field.
That brings up Ken Aspromonte. Dick McAuliffe on first base. Stoneman on the mound. And there's a bouncer hit back through the middle for a base hit. And Dick McAuliffe moves on down to second base. So that puts two men aboard. McAuliffe on second, Aspromonte on first. And the batter now is Willie Horton. Willie has had quite a night. He's hit two home runs.
Knocked in five runs.
Here's the pitch from Stoneman, and there's a high drive going to deep left center field. And that ball is out of here. How about that? A three-run home run for Willie Horton to make it 24-11. And his third home run of the game, and eight runs batted in.
You take those kind of numbers every night, wouldn't you, Bill?
Oh, yeah. And you'll also take that cheer home as the most valuable player.
And so the American League leads by a score of 24-11. And that brings to the plate Milt Pappas, who, when pitching to the Cubs in 1972, missed a perfect game by one pitch.
Ball three, strike two, two out. Perfect game on the line. No hitter on the line. Watch it. It's a ball. And Pappas is in range. Ball four. There goes the perfect game. The no-hitter is still intact. Fleming, the umpire, walks out. He knows what's on the line here. He knows how important this is. He has his job to do.
I'm sorry that Mr. Fleming didn't see fit to call one of those pitches a strike, and they were, as far as I thought they were all right on the outside corner. And then, you know, his classic remark was, name me one umpire that ever called a perfect game. And I told him how stupid he was that he could have been a 10th ever, and he could tell his kids and his grandkids and his great-grandchildren. I said, that's how dumb you are.
There's a high fly ball. Short right, should be caught. Fan zone's out there on the grass. He has it. It's a no-hitter for Pappas.
I think Ron Santo, I think, epitomized the situation very well when he said it's the first time he's ever had a letdown after a no-hitter. I felt great. I was elated because obviously it was my first no-hitter that I ever pitched. But after the night wore on and I realized what I really missed, then I got very upset, the fact that I should have had the perfect game.
That was a tough break for Milt. I know what it is to pitch a perfect game. I saw Don Larson do it. Full count. Strike three, and he's not even bothering to run. Let's go down to Bill White as he talks with Willie Horton.
Are you aware that the MVP of this game gets a rocker, and you're trying to take it from your former teammate, Bill Freehand?
Well, I ain't ready to go in a rocking chair. I may accept it, but I ain't ready to go in a rocking chair. Well, it's just great to be here, Bill.
Yeah.
See all the guys play against you and guys you play with. That's your blessing. That's helping you write a good chapter to your story life. Thank you.
And thank you, Willie Horton, for the great evening you've given to us and to all the fans. Here's Mike Epstein. He has two strikes on him. There are two outs. American League leading 24-11, and that's strike three. And that ends the first half of the fifth inning, with the American League out in front by a score of 24-11. The National League will be coming up for its last time at bat, and they need at least two touchdowns to win this ball game. And they'll have coming up Ina Slaughter, Johnny Callison, and Sam Jethro.
Characters of the Game, brought to you by A&W Root Beer. Sit back and pour yourself a frosty one.
After the no-hitter, it got out of hand. I mean, it wasn't your typical no-hitter pitched in Kansas City or Cleveland.
It could only happen in Hollywood. Bo Belinsky tosses a no-hitter, and suddenly he's a star among stars and a ladies' man of major proportions. It seemed everybody wanted a piece of Bo, and he was all too happy to accommodate. Yes, his legend will forever be secure, not for his performances during the game, but for those great performances after the game. No doubt no one ever made more of 28 lifetime victories than Bo Belinsky, a character of the game.
I guess I was trying to kill myself with beautiful women. Didn't accomplish it.
Baseball Classic has been sponsored by Bud Light. Everything else is just a light. Ice Blue Aqua Belva, because there's something about an Ice Blue Aqua Belva man. And by Metropolitan Life and Affiliated Companies. Get Met. It pays.
Jim Nance, Mel Allen, and Bill White here in the bottom of the fifth. Last at bat for the National League, trailing 24-11. An original member of the Los Angeles Angels, Ned Garber, facing Country Slaughter, a Hall of Famer, career 300 hitter.
Slaughter came to the Yankees from the St. Louis Cardinals in August of 56. In order to get on the roster, the Yankees had to release a man, and that was Phil Rizzuto, who wound up as a result in the broadcasting booth.
As a result of Slaughter coming over.
Yeah.
Look at Slaughter swinging to right field. Base hit, well, he can still swing the bat. At age 71, retired tobacco farmer in North Carolina, and they're going to bring in a pinch runner for him. It's Bill Stoneman, who struck out the last two batters in the bottom of the fourth. Now batting for the National League, Johnny Callison, who had a very memorable moment, 1964 in the All-Star game.
Swing and there.
Well, when I went around the bases, I didn't even feel like I was touching them. I just felt like I was flying. And then when I got home plate, to have everybody there, you know, Mantle, Mays, or not Mantle, but Mays and Clemente, just all the great ball players that were on that team, it was such a thrill that I was just happy to be there. And I was still on cloud nine when I finished.
Bill, you were there that day at Shea in 1964. What was your involvement?
Well, I pinch hit before Callison and struck out, so I was glad when Callison hit it out.
Bouncing ball to McAuliffe and a little flip over to Aspermonte for the put out at second, and that's the first out here in the bottom of the fifth. Jim Cott comes in now, 283 game winner, 16 gold gloves, perhaps the greatest fielding pitcher of all time, and they'll face Sam Jethro, 1950 National League Rookie of the Year. Here's a ground ball to Boyer, to Aspromonte, and back over to first for the double play, and that'll do it. The American League has won it 24-11, a game that has seen 13 home runs. And as promised, these outstanding old-timers have sparked our baseball memories back to life for just a brief moment once again. Well, for Mel Allen and Bill White, this is Jim Nance saying so long from RFK Stadium in Washington, D.C., where the American League has won it 24-11.
Born
think